Beruchim Abayim, we continue the story of Avram and his quarrels with the evil king Nimrod. So Hashem ordered Avram to go to Babylon and to see Nimrod. Avram obviously was afraid, and Hashem, he sent him Malach Gabriel. It's funny how Gabriel is connected a lot to Abraham, as you will see, and not Michael. It was more Gabriel than anything. So Gabriel calmed him down. You don't need to worry. You don't need any horses. You don't need any warriors. Just come with me. And a trip of 40 days, which we'll read later, took him one day. And even the sorcerers, Nimrod's astrologers, knew that Avram was on God's side, that God was with Avram, the real God, the God of gods, like they say. So he gets to Babylon, and he meets his father and his mother. And when Terach heard these words, he persuaded Avram to follow him into the house, where his son told him all that had happened and so forth. So Terach went to Nimrod, and he reported that Avram, his son, appeared suddenly in Babylon. And the king sent for Avram, and he came before with his father. And Avram was very challenging. He's like, "Oh, Nimrod, thou contemptible wretch that denies the essence of faith, that denies the living and immutable God." And he continued, he's like, "God is the living, ever-existing God, the God of all gods. How dare you? How dare you not believe in God and worship all these foolish idols and stones?" While Avram proclaimed this with a loud voice. Again, Avram was very, how do we say, very challenged, voracious. He was very sure of himself. He very passionate, extremely passionate. And as he was proclaiming this, the idols fell upon their faces, and King Nimrod as well. For a space of 2.5 hours, the king lay lifeless. And when his soul returned upon him, he's like, "Oh, Avram," or the voice, "is that the voice of Avram or the voice of God?" And Avram answered, "The voice is the voice of the least of all creatures called into existence by God." And Nimrod acknowledged, "Verily, the God of Abraham is a great and powerful God." And he sent him away. He ordered him and his father to leave the castle and to go back. When Avram was 20 years old, his father Terach fell ill. He got sick, and he spoke as father to his sons, "Haran, Avram, I adjure you by your lives, my son, sell these two idols for me, for I have not enough money to meet our expenses." So Haran executed the wish of his father. But Avram, he started to fool around a bit. He's like, when somebody came to get an idol, he would ask him, "How much?" "It's 3 money. And then he would say, "How old are you?" He's like, "30 years old." "So you're going to tell me you at 30 are going to worship an idol that was built today?" And he would dispute with him. Then an older lady came to him. He's like, "How much for this idol?" He said, 4 or 5 money, whatever the key. And he's like, "How old are you?" 50 years old, and same thing. Avram would be like, "So what? You're 50 years old, you're going to worship and bow down to an idol that was created today?" And thereupon the man would depart and go his way. So the people would leave, and Avram then took 2 idols, put a rope about their necks, and with their faces turned downwards, he dragged them along the ground, crying aloud all the time, "Who will buy an idol wherein there is no profit, either unto itself or unto him that buys it in order to worship it? It has a mouth, but it cannot speak. It has eyes, but it cannot see. It has feet, but it cannot walk. It has ears, but it cannot hear." And again, once again, people were coming, and Abraham was just rebuking them, refuting them, fact-checking them, whatever you want to call it. And And he won. And he won. To the point where that old woman, she's like, if you're seeing the truth, then I will serve the God of all gods, the God of Abraham. And that came to the word of Nimrod. Nimrod started to be afraid because Avram was starting to garner a lot of partisanship. He was starting to gather a lot of supporters. He was becoming he wasn't the minority anymore. He wasn't negligible. He was becoming the majority. And that scared the hell out of Nimrod. So Nimrod came up with a plan. First of all, he killed that old woman. So Nimrod, he wanted to prepare a big feast, a big meal to show the wealth and the power of Nimrod, to terrify him. You know, he wanted to show Avram, listen, I'm not here some peasant, I'm the king of kings, Nimrod. So Nimrod invited Avram to come before him that he might have the opportunity of seeing his greatness and wealth. But Avram refused to appear before the king. On the other hand, he granted his father's request that in his absence, he sit by his idols and the kings and take care of them. So what did Avram do? He took an axe and he destroyed all the king's idols. From the biggest to the smallest, he beheaded them. He took away the feet. He struck out the eyes. He crushed the hands. He mutilated every single idol that the king had. And he put it in the hand of the largest idol. When the feast ended, the king returned, and when he saw his idols shivered in pieces. What happened? Who did this? Who perpetrated this mischief? Abraham said, I didn't do anything. The one who's guilty is the one that has the axe. I didn't do anything. I did not do it. It was the largest of the idols who shattered all the rest. He was jealous. He wanted to be king of kings. And he killed all the others. And if you don't believe me, if you don't believe my words, then you can ask the idol. And Nimrod really saw that Abraham was becoming the threat that the astrologer saw many, many years ago. Now the king was exceedingly angry, mad, furious to Avram. He sent Avram to jail, in prison, with no bread and no water. Avram stayed there for 1 year. No bread and no water. It's not true. He prayed and prayed. And Malach Gabriel again came to Avram. He's like, whatever you need, I will give bread, water, whatever he needed. Avram was quenched his thirst. He satiated his starvation. He ate well. It's written right here. Like I was saying, Avram, 1 second, let me get the information. Yeah, so he created him a well of water, spring of fresh water welled up before him, and he drank it. And he provided him with all sorts of food. This is Malach, the angel Gabriel. At the end of the year, the magnates of the realm presented themselves before the king and advised him to cast Avram into the fire. Let's throw him into the fire. They all assumed that Avram was dead. No eating, no drinking for a year. They all assumed that he was dead. Nimrod said, if he's alive, let's throw him. If he's dead, even better. Let's throw his carcass into the fire. So the warden reminded the king that Avram had not had any food or drink the whole year, like I said, but Nimrod nevertheless desired him to step in front of the prison and call his name. When he called his name, Avram, are you there? And Avram said, I am living, ani chai. Who has been bringing you food and drinks? And Avram replied, food and drink have been bestowed upon me by him who is all over things, the God of gods and the Lord of all lords, who alone does all his wonders. He who is the God of Nimrod and the God of Terach and the God of the whole world, he dispenses food and drink unto all beings. He sees what he cannot see. he is in heaven above. Once again, the miraculous rescue of Avram really shook the king's magnates and sorcerers and astrologers and counselors. They were reluctant to take Avram because they knew that God himself, Hashem, Yibarach Shemo La'ad, the eternal, he is God, the God of the whole world, as well as of the blasphemer Nimrod, was on the side of Avram. They even tried to behead him, but the sword could not cut his flesh. The harder it was pressed against his throat, the more it broke into pieces. Nimrod prepared a fiery fire, very high fire, and he invited the whole city, the whole kingdom, to bring wood so the fire could be as high as the heaven and to throw Avram into the furnace. There was also Haran. Haran, who was the brother of Avram, and he's like, you know, he wasn't sure. That's the problem right now. Avram was 100% sure that Hashem was Hashem. Haran had some doubt. And we'll see what happens to Haran. So finally they decide to throw Avram. And whoever tries to throw him, he is the one that falls into the furnace. Many died, several died trying to throw Avram. So Satan, disguised as a counselor, as the counsel of Nimrod, mentioned we should do a catapult. Nobody touches Avram. He goes into the catapult and we throw him in the fire. And Nimrod accepted. And Satan, disguised as a counselor, went to Avram and he's like, listen, you know, you could survive if you just say that Nimrod is your God. And Avram didn't want to know a thing. He didn't want to know a thing of Satan. He was, God is the God Almighty. Nothing will convince me of the opposite. He told the Satan that the fire of God will never die. This fire of Nimrod will one day extinguish, but the fire of Hashem is eternal. Nonetheless, Satan tried, but to no avail. And they threw Avram in the fire, and he didn't burn. And there's even the Midrash that say that the wood that was in the fire, no water was needed to extinguish the fire. The logs burst into buds, les bourgeons, and all the different kinds of wood put forth fruit, each tree bearing its own kind. The furnace was transformed into a royal pleasance, and the angels sat therein with Avram. When the king saw that, he's like, witchcraft, sorcery. But the princes of Nimrod, the counselors, the sorcerers, the astrologers interposed and like, no, my lord. This is not witchcraft. This is the power of the great God, the God of Abraham. They saw what Hashem, the real God, was able to do. So Avram survived the fiery furnace of Nimrod. And I was saying about his brother Haran. Haran wasn't sure. He's like, okay, if Avram survives the fire, then I know that Hashem is the real God. If he dies, then I know it's Nimrod. So when Haran jumped, he burnt because his emunah was not 100%. Haran was consumed by the fire. Haran was irresolute in his faith. He could not decide whether to adhere to Abraham or the idolaters. And like I said, when he saw Abraham survive the fire, then he decided to jump. And when he did, it was too late because his emunah was not pure. Haran was burnt and his daughter Sarah became the wife of Abraham. So Abraham married his niece. So Haran had a daughter, which was Sarai. And Sarai was the niece of Abraham. Again, this is before Torah and all that, so let's not get into another discussion which has nothing to do with what we're talking about. This is how it is. And then you'll see what happens with Lot. So let's not get into that debate. But Sarai became Avram's wife. The king, the princes, and all the people who had been witness of the wonders done by Avram came to him and prostrated themselves before him. But Avram said, "Do not bow down before me, but before God." Not only is Avram courageous, not only is he strong and resolute, not only does he not cower in the face of Satan, but he's very humble. He's like, "It's not me that does all these miracles. Don't think that I'm the God. Don't think that I'm Chas v'Shalom, a miracle worker. No, it's Hashem, Yitbarach Shemo La'ad." And it's funny how he doesn't mention Gabriel, but Hashem, because Gabriel is only there because Hashem sent him. And once again, Avram proselytized, converted many, many, many thousands of people to Hashem, to, I'm not going to say Judaism, but to monotheism. And that's why it's written, I forgot in a parasha, that Avram made men. There's different commentaries where we say that Avram is the author of the Sefer Yetzirah, and that he made golems to transport his riches and as slaves and helpers. But there's another commentary when he says that he made men, M-E-N, is that he turned them into God-fearing, worshiping people. Shortly after, ויאמר השם אל אברהם לך לך מארצך וממולדתך ומבית אביך אל הארץ אשר אראך. So here Abraham is commanded to leave Haran and to go to a land that he doesn't know, which is going to be Canaan. That's going to be for another time. We're going to see how Abraham adjusts to his new city, country that he will inherit without him knowing, because he had no idea. He followed blindly the words of Hashem.